growing up, I was always taught not to swim in the river. Because it definitely is nasty at some parts, and it has that nasty history. I've grown up in Chicago my whole life, mainly on the north side, and I've sort of been on Chicago's water my whole life, whether it was the river or the lake, sailing, surfing, when we can get it.
Hey.
How's it going?
Good to see you.
You too. All
right. With mussels,
yeah.
Everyone's first instinct is you want to name them, but the names are always really uncreative that people come up with. It's like Shelly, or which are good, which are fine, but it's still like, come up with a couple, or like a Reginald. Who's ever gonna see a Reginald coming with a mussel name? That's right, Reggie.
I'm Phil Nicodemus. I'm our research director at Urban Rivers, and I do everything related to figuring out what makes these floating wetlands work well in urban environments and other types of habitat things that we need to do to improve the health of ecosystems.
I love that.
But we gotta rear them first. This is the easy part.
Yeah. When I came to Phil, I had the idea of building a artificial reef for Lake Michigan.
Wow.
He sort of helped me mold that idea into a mussel bunker, which is an artificial habitat for mussels on the Chicago River.
There's millions of people who live in a city who don't understand what it means to be a part of an ecosystem, to be part of the environment. Thus, the Wild Mile is born. Thus, the Bubbly Creek and River Park installations that we have just put in are very important because they get a foothold of nature into these places and they build a sense of community around the river. The city of Chicago, founded on this really unique point in the continent where it's the crossroads of a lot of different things. It's this naturally kind of dune-dominated swampy area, but all of it creates this really interesting biodiversity hotspot. When humans kind of came on the scene, when it's first Native Americans, they're using it as the portage between the Great Lakes and the Mississippi River system, connecting a lot of cultures and communities as a big gathering place. When colonizers came on the scene, it kind of became much more dominated for industrial and commercial purposes. The rest of the river system completely dredged and channelized and made into this big box. Sheer seawalls, wooden back in the day, but replaced by concrete and steel.
Our canal was dug in 1850, and it was dug to about 18 feet deep. At this point, it's about 5 feet deep. And so all of that in between is sediment that have just accumulated over the last 180 years. If you go down in it, you'll see just layers of different pollution. It's kind of like an ice core where you can see this is when the coal-fired power plant was there. This is when the paint factory started operating.
As people were also using it as a sewer system, this pollution ended up tainting their water supply coming right off the lake, and you have these severe cholera outbreaks and things like this. And that followed along with the development of the rest of the city. All these swamps and wetlands got turned into parking lots, and they got turned into clay pits and, you know, all these different things that went into building the city. The landscape was changed entirely for that.
There's our best friend in the world. That's right.
Morning, Nick. Morning. Morning, Bubba.
How are you guys?
Good. How about yourself?
Couldn't be better.
Fantastic.
Oh, yeah.
in the same way that all the highways look the same, the rivers look the same, cheap concrete or steel walls. And since we've stopped using them for transportation, they've kind of fallen into disrepair. You know, they're kind of this architectural relic. And so our approach is to look at how can we take this existing structure and try to rewild it, try to create something that kind of emulates what a natural ecosystem would be, and do it in an area that is densely populated, where there is a real lack of green space and a real lack of a connection to an ecosystem, and try to bring these types of things back.
All right, so here's our substrate. Just regular old sand, clean sand.
Gotcha.
We probably want to fill each one of these up to, obviously, the holes.
All right. Our two main goals in designing this mussel bunker was to help keep predators out, such as muskrats, beavers, and to help keep the mussels in place so that they can survive and thrive throughout their entire lives and sort of help rebuild those mussel populations on the river.
All right, just right here.
When you look at the river in general, you'll notice that you can't really see very deep
into
it.
Yeah.
You know, it's pretty turbid. There's not a lot of ways that light can get deep into it. And because of that, you don't get a lot of the plants and other wildlife that would grow on the river bottom.
Yeah.
Adding mussels, since they filter, you know, 10, 15 gallons of water per mussel per day,
wow,
they'll start to make the water clarity better, which then means light goes deeper, which means plants can actually occupy that river bottom. And when that starts to happen, it starts to kind of rejuvenate the whole cycle and create a better space for them to live, and they'll start reproducing more and more and come back to the populations that used to really inhabit this.
Gotcha.
We pulled this out too, isn't this beautiful?
It's quite haunted.
Yeah, I pulled that out, I thought it was really special. It deserved to be on the wall.
We have a lot of volunteers who go out, get in a kayak, and pick up trash, pull them out, categorize them, and then we log all of that data in a database that's used by another researcher. We have three shifts a day, you know, 4 days a week, so hundreds of people are able to make a huge difference in this.
It is fascinating, the things we find, it really is. Yes. We pulled out two sleds today. We saw them hanging last week, and we were able to get them down today.
Paper bags,
two.
Plastic bottles, so we...
Plastic bottles, probably 32.
Rope. Now we got rubbers. Rubber stuff.
Rubber stuff. I can interpret
it. Tires, yes. It's kind of ironic we're here. I'm kind of a science nerd, and I was looking for something scientific-y to do. And one of the things I would search with would be microscopes, and that's what brought me to urban rivers. But that didn't seal the deal. It was when it was like, wait a minute, I can look through a microscope and I can kayak the same day. And so I think I'm a perfect example of what I think we want to do at urban rivers is get people to be near the river, to see the river, and start understanding what needs to be done.
People assume science is this high-minded and very technically complex thing, but really, at the end of the day, we're all scientists. The first papers in ecology and science that are ever published are just some guy going out in his boat and throwing a net in and recording what he caught. We develop a question, we figure out a way to answer it, and figure out ways that our assumptions about things might be wrong. But at some point, we get told that there's a gatekeeper somewhere, and that's really not true.
And that's, I think, part of what volunteers can help us with is also getting through to folks who maybe think this isn't them, but in reality it is. You know, it is everybody. Anybody who has time and the desire to learn more about their environment, those are the kind of people we've always looked for.
And then you flip these up, and then they click on, and then flip it down. Your phone will always be here, and the camera will always be there.
Okay.
All right?
Sweet.
Yeah? Have fun.
Doing some underwater filming under our farther islands today, checking out the root structure and see how far our plants have come along over the years.
Hold up.
We're building spaces that are really unique in this habitat, so understanding the long-term impacts of the growth of the plants, really how they're doing, is important to us, and the roots are a really great way to indicate overall health of a plant and the ecosystem it's building. Our plants grow hydroponically down through the gardens directly into the river, and those roots provide a really unique kind of root jungle habitat down below that have been missing from our riverbanks for a long time. So getting underwater footage is really useful for us, not only to see what's happening, but to really study and track that kind of change over time as the plants grow older.
We've really reached the first rung of the journey. You know, we have the Wild Mile, which is the first floating eco park of its kind, where we combine these wetlands, other habitat amenities and things like that, along with open space.
Turning these river spaces away from something that people occasionally walk their dogs down to a place where people gather and can like really connect with this stuff is the important piece. That is something that really inspires people, and you don't have to be an environmentalist to kind of enjoy that stuff.
Yeah.
Especially in the cities, providing a place where they can have an impact. I think it helps us a lot psychologically, but also getting people outdoors, getting people in the sun, you know, these are all good things for human health.
I joke like one of the markers of success when I know we're there is the moment this kind of becomes boring, where people come down to the Wild Mile or to another park that we've worked on, and they're like, oh, another one of those, you know? And it becomes kind of so enmeshed in the day-to-day experience of a person that it really blends in and it feels like it's always been there.
Definitely have a vision for what the river could be, because I think it's sort of cool in the fact that the city is progressing and moving forward. I think if we keep going at the pace we are, then the river's only going upwards from here.